All right, our theme has been, we're actually in a text where we find the theme for the book. And it's in chapter 3, verse 14. It says, "Although I hope to come to you soon, I am writing these instructions so that if I am delayed, you will know how people ought to conduct themselves." How to conduct themselves in church is the theme here, but I've modified that to getting the most out of church. Because when we conduct ourselves the way we should before God, we will get the most out of church. That will, you know, just be the way it is. This theme follows a catalog of qualifications for godly leaders. Remember last time there were at least 28 different fill-in-the-blanks. I think that's the most I've ever put in a bulletin, right? Because there are 28 qualifications. Now, I know three of them were overlaps and that kind of thing, but when we looked at that catalog of lists, he gives us those things that they ought to be doing, and he says, "Now, although I hope to come to you soon, I'm writing these things, these instructions, that if I'm delayed, you will know how people ought to conduct themselves." He gave us that list to know this is what godly leaders do. All right? So, now, after having given that list, he is going to say, "I've got four reasons why you want to do that." And the first one is because of who we are. All right? Because of who we are. And first of all, we are God's household. God's household. You will know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's household. He says here, "Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you?" The moment I accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior at 8 years old, something happened that I didn't even realize. I didn't even feel that it was going on, was happening. And I didn't feel it, I didn't see it, I didn't hear it. It was an invasion of my body by the Holy Spirit of God. And he took residence within me so that he indwells me. He says, "Don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God, and you are not your own. You were bought with a price, therefore glorify God with your body." Something unusual happened that day. You see, God owns me two times. He owns me by creation. He created me. He created you. And he owns me by redemption. There's a story, I don't know if you've heard the story, it was a children's story about the little boy who his dad and him had built this little model boat. And they took it down and they were floating it in a little stream and it got carried away and it went on down the stream and they chased like crazy but they couldn't find it. The faster they ran, the faster it would go. And finally, when they finally gave up looking for it, they found that just had to give up. So one day the little boy's walking through town and he notices in the hobby shop window a boat. His boat. And so he goes in, he says, "That's my boat." He said, "No, I bought that boat from a gentleman that came in. I bought that boat, and that's my boat." And he said, "No, but that's my boat. I built it." He said, "Yeah, but I bought that boat. It's my boat." He says, "Well, how much is the boat?" And he says, "Well, it was like $5. And he says, so he goes back home, and he has to work, and he has to do all these things. He gets his $5. He goes in, and he buys the boat that he had made. And walking out, he says, "You are twice mine." And that's what this text is all about. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who's in you? The moment you accepted Christ, who created your body, he invaded you. Whom you have received from God, you are not your own. You were bought with a price. God owns you. The proof of his ownership is the presence of the Holy Spirit of God. He is the seal. So that when God looks down from heaven and says, which ones are mine? He sees the Holy Spirit residing within us and says, "That one belongs to me." We are God's household. He says also, not only are we God's household, but we are the assembly of God. You will know how people ought to conduct themselves, he says, in God's household, which is the church of the living God. And there we have the word church in Greek, because the New Testament was originally written in Greek. And you see it like the letter EK on the front, Epsilon Kappa. Those two little letters mean out of. It's a preposition. And what they did is they slammed it on the word klesia. Now, in the word klesia from the word kaleo, you can almost hear the word call. Kaleo, call. Our Greek word's built on that. It means to call. But when you put the little preposition on the front, it means to call out. Now, when I was a kid, growing up in Detroit, in my neighborhood, you didn't go over and knock on the door to invite someone out. Anybody remember what we did in the city? We would yell, and then, oh, Victor. Only I'd shout it really loud, right? And then if Victor was home, he'd come to the door. If he wasn't home, well, I was calling him out. You see, that's what I said. I was calling him out. And when God saved me and when God saved you, he called you out of all the world. And he's gathered us together as a people. The church is nothing more than all those people he's called out of the world to be his people. For Jesus said, I will build my church. We are Christ's people. And it says here, we are the church of the living God. That's a powerful statement. Here, the church belongs to God, the living God. We are the church of the living God. But Jesus said, I will build my church. So if Jesus is the one, it's his church, this passage is saying it's the living God's church. What does that make Jesus? Jesus is the living God. You see, the Bible has everywhere, all through it, just woven in the New Testament, this doctrine of the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the true and living God. We are the people of God. Now, next he goes on, he says, we are not only the church of the living God, but we are the pillar of the truth. Several years ago, we were in Italy, and we were at Pompeii. And I took a picture of this pillar at Pompeii. I guess I could write the trip off as a business trip now. Probably not. But I took this picture because it's the pillar of truth. It stands tall. It stands out. It supports the rest of the structure. And the Bible is saying the church is the pillar. We should stand out in our society. We should be the ones who are proclaiming the truth. Even if it's countercultural or not politically correct, we stand for the truth. And he says, not only do we stand for the truth, but we are based on the truth. The foundation, actually the foundation is the truth itself. We have a foundation upon which we build our lives. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. We Christians build ourselves on what Jesus said. That's why we search the scriptures, we study the scriptures, we want to talk about the scripture, we talk about Jesus, his life, its impact on us. And what we have here is we are the church, pillars of truth, built upon the absolute foundation of the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only do we have the reason because we have the Word of God, and I notice there's a typo in this. How many have noticed that right away? Okay, I got one that noticed it right away. What Jesus did, you see. One of the reasons why we can get the most out of church is because what Jesus did. He says, beyond all question, the mystery of godliness is great. Now, the term mystery, for most of us, mystery is something you don't know. If you read a mystery novel, you start reading it, and you're trying to unravel it because you don't know the answer. In the ancient world, they viewed it differently. They viewed the mystery as something that you do know, but before you did not know. They didn't view it from the perspective that I don't know it and I'm hoping to find it out. They viewed it like, I do know this now, but I used to not know this. And that was a mystery before, and that's why it was called a mystery. And what he's saying here is beyond all question, the mystery, what I didn't know about godliness is great. What didn't they know in Old Testament times? And here's what he says, that he appeared in a body. Now, some texts have actually that God appeared in the body. The difference between the two would be just the letters, just the letter T-E. Because the word T-E attached to the word that we have here that most modern translations build it on is O-S. And if you put those together, it's really the T is a TH in Greek, so it's theos. Theos appeared in a body, or you leave it as the OS, who appeared in the body. Okay? And so you'll read different translations, you'll see some that'll say, God appeared in a body, and that's true. And to say, who appeared in the body, referring to Christ, since we've already established that he is God, is saying the exact same thing. God appeared in the body. We build our faith on, and this is the reason why we follow Jesus and the way he tells us to follow him, is because he actually appeared. And we celebrated this at Christmas, that the Word of God became flesh and dwelt among us. We go on, it says he was vindicated by the Spirit. It was, he set the record straight. It was right. It was correct by the Spirit. The Spirit of God is the one who worked in the body of Mary so that she brought forth the righteous one, the Holy One, Jesus. It was the Holy Spirit who leads Jesus into the wilderness, and so he does what is right. It is the Holy Spirit that's there at his baptism when he's fulfilled all righteousness. It is the Holy Spirit that we're told, Romans chapter 1, that was the power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. It's the Holy Spirit everywhere. He's vindicating, authenticating who Jesus is. The Holy Spirit. And was seen by angels. Seen by angels. It was the angels that appeared to Mary, tell her that she was going to have a son, a boy. It was the angels, okay, who rolled away the stone. It was the angels later that when Jesus ascends into heaven and says, why are you standing looking up into heaven? The same Jesus that was taken up from you is going to come in the same way as you've seen him go. It was the angels that did that. He was seen by angels. He goes on and he says, and he was preached among the nations. The whole book of Acts is being unfolded here that they're going on missionary journeys and trips, and they're taking the message of the gospel is being preached among all the nations. And it says, and he was believed on in the world. So that in Colossians chapter 1, he says this message has gone throughout the whole world. God had providentially raised up the Roman Empire with its wonderful Roman roads so they could travel along all those roads and they could take the gospel to all the far regions of the known world. And then he says, and he was taken up into glory. Jesus ascended into heaven. He's at the right hand of the Father. And he's awaiting the day when the Father says, it's time to return. And he will come and gather those of his church out of this world at the rapture. You notice that there's kind of like a poetical structure to this, the way they place it in modern Bibles. It is believed by many theologians, New Testament scholars, that this passage is actually an early church hymn. What do they sing? They sang theology. They sang theology. They put doctrine to music because it's easier to learn and memorize that way, right? If I were to ask some of you, quote for me a passage of Scripture, you'd say, well, I got a verse. No, give me 10 verses in a row. I can't do that. But if I were to ask you to, quote the words to Amazing Grace, boom, you'd go right down all those words. Why? Because there's meter, there's rhyme, and it flows together. The early church did the same. This is believed to be one of those. It's like a creed, but yet it's musical, or it was in the day, and they would sing this, and people could recall it and hang on to it. And he says, you know what? We get the most out of church when we know who Jesus is, and we've got that embedded in our minds. We go into the next chapter, chapter 4, and he says, we know the reason why we get the most out of church is because of what we oppose. Not that we're oppositional, it's more that they're oppositional to us. Now, if I'm in a game, I'm on offense, the opponent is on defense. If I'm on defense, the opponent is on offense. But I'm opposing, there's opposition going on. And he says here, the Spirit clearly says that in latter times, some will desert. There'll be deserting people. There'll be some who will oppose us. He says, the Spirit says, some will abandon the faith. They will start off, but something will happen, and they will let go of their faith, and they will go back into the world in which they were. In the book of Hebrews, he's arguing in the book, don't go back to Judaism, because Judaism is finished. That was a shadow, and you have reality. And you read in the book, and you find that some were being persecuted, and he says, why would you go back? You haven't even endured persecution yet to the point of shedding your own blood. When I read something like that, he's saying, what? I am supposed to resist temptation to the point where I would even spill my blood to stand for it? And he said, for some, they were not standing firm. They were going back into Judaism. And part of the problem was they were saying, well, you know, the persecution is too great. So what I will do is I'll still be a Christian, but I'm going to act like I'm Jewish so I don't get persecuted. People were deserting beyond that. We saw that earlier in the book. He said, I've given two men over for the destruction of their flesh. Okay? He's handed them over to Satan, he actually said. And so there's those who will desert. You know, remember the parable of the Lord told us, well, the sower went out and he was sowing the seed, and some seed fell on stony ground, and in between the cracks it caught root and it popped up real quickly. All right? And then the sun came out and the east wind, and it got scorched and wind-blown, and it starts to dry up and shrivels away. And then when Jesus interprets it, he says, oh yeah, it sprouts up quickly like those who receive the message with great joy, but they have no depth of root. And so when a difficult time comes along, a problem in their life exists, it's like the wind blowing, the sun scorching it, and because it has no depth in its faith, it is soon shriveled and withered and gone away. They've deserted us. There are those who don't finish well. They're eager to jump in, but at the first little sign of difficulty, they bail. They bail. He goes on and says, not only clearly the Spirit says that in latter times, some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits. Deceiving spirits. Even Satan himself, okay, doesn't appear in some red outfit like I got on the screen. And he doesn't appear as some devious, evil villain. He doesn't have the pitchfork or he doesn't hit you with a tail. Okay? I mean, that is grotesque. That is ugly. What is attractive about that? Nothing. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, it says that he is an angel of light. He masquerades. He pretends that he's going to do something wonderful for you. He entices you like he did Eve in the garden. Hey, if you eat of the forbidden fruit, you'll be like God. He's deceiving. He lies. He tells you when you're on the diet and you know you shouldn't. Oh, there's no calories in that cake. You relating, huh? You know how that works. He says to the guy at work, hey, there's no problem in flirting with that secretary. I mean, after all, you just... she'll smile and she'll laugh. That's okay. And guess what? Every time you do those, when you eat that cake, it's so delicious. When what you said was found funny by that person, you know, that you shouldn't have been flirting with, it makes you feel so good. Why is that? Hebrews tells us there is pleasure in sin for a season. For a season. For a season. You know that season of eating that cake, then you go in next day, you step on the scales, and can I sidetrack for a moment? I did Weight Watchers once. I did Weight Watchers, and I snuck up behind my buddies that we were doing it with. He was standing on the scale, and I snuck up behind and just pushed down a little bit. The gal behind the counter had his book. All right? And she looked at the book, looked at what it was reading, because you can't see it. It's on their side. You can see it. Looked at him. Looked at his book. Looked at that. About third time around, she noticed me back there. She said, oh, I didn't know how I was going to tell him he gained 15 pounds in 1 week. Hey, you know how it is, though. It tastes so delicious, but then the next day you step on those scales, and what? You find that the sin was seasonal. It's gone. Now you got to live with the pain. The guy that flirts, and the flirt turns into sexual harassment, now he's got to live with the pain. You see what I'm saying? It seems so wonderful. It's deceiving spirits trying to trick you, deceive you to do something that is going to be oh so fun and oh so lovely, but in the end it will bite and sting like death itself. That's deceiving spirits. They oppose us. They oppose us. Things taught by demons. 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 Even the abuse of the Lord's Supper, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, is motivated by demons. False doctrine motivated by demons. There are so many cults out there that deny the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ, motivated by demons. So many falsehoods motivated by demons. Why? Because demons oppose everything that is right and good. And they are led by Satan himself, who is in all-out warfare with God, and he knows that his own doom is sealed, but he feels like he wants to take as many of us with him as he can. It's a spiritual war, a spiritual battle. He goes on and says, then there's these deceptive hypocrites. Such teachings come through hypocritical liars. You know, so I got that beautiful mask on there. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah. The word for hypocrite is actually the word for wearing a mask. In the ancient Greek theater, everybody was playing a part, but only men got roles. So if they needed a female player in the play, they normally would take a young adolescent boy whose voice had not yet changed so that he had a higher frequency like a female, and they would wear masks to portray the characters in the play rather than let their faces be seen. And the whole idea is you're pretending to be something that you are not. Deceptive hypocrites. Such teachings come through hypocritical liars. They're lying to you and pretending to be something that they are not, whose consciences have been seared with a hot iron. The Bible is interesting. That conscience is that part of you that passes judgment on what you say or what you do, what you think or how you act. It judges, was that good or bad? And my conscience does two things. It either accuses me and said, oh, Dennis, you are such a terrible hypocrite. God could never accept you. You could never be saved. You can't be saved because a saved person doesn't do anything like that. You can't be a godly man. Godly people don't do things like that. And it accuses you until you feel just so worth it, you can't do it. And you say, what's the use? And you give up. It either accuses me or it excuses me. And I say, well, okay, that was bad. But it's not as bad as, and then you think it's somebody who you know is really bad. I'm not as bad as Saddam Hussein. I'm not as bad as a Hitler. I'm not, you know. And so rather than see myself for what it really is, confess and repent and say, God, I blew it. You know, and remember that verse in 1 John 1, 9, where it says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And I know that, you know, as a Christian, I've been there and I got on my knees and pray, God, I did it again. Here I am again. I'm confessing the same thing as I did last week. And somewhere back in my mind, in my conscience, I hear the Lord saying, what do you mean again? I'm faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. The word forgive means to release me of the guilt associated with what I've done or thought. He releases me. He never holds me accountable for that again. The only one holding myself accountable after I've confessed it in genuine repentance is me. So he says, what do you mean again? I confess my sin. He's faithful and just. I don't play a hypocrite and excuse myself. When I do accuse myself, I then confess it, and God restores me into all righteousness. Deceptive hypocrites. They're depriving people. They forbid people to marry. Now, in our culture today, this forbidding comes in this form. Don't get married, just live with the person. Why would you get, test it out. Maybe it's not going to work. Do you realize that sociological research shows that people who live together before they get married are over 50% more likely to divorce when they do marry than when they do not live together before? Is that amazing? If the people have children from a previous relationship, it just skyrockets even higher yet. This whole testing it out is not the way it's supposed to be. Forbidding to marry. Oh, no, test it out first. No. And some of them are ordering you that you abstain from certain foods. Don't eat meat is probably the big one of our day. They're ordering them abstain from certain foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and who know the truth. Did you notice that? To be received with thanksgiving. Watch what goes on next verse. For everything God created is good. After the flood, God commanded that you, mankind, could eat from the animals. There are unclean animals that they were not supposed to eat of, according to the dietary regulations in the book of Leviticus. But he says, every creature is good, and nothing to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving. Because it is consecrated by the word of God. God said so. And prayer, when you give thanks for your food. I don't know. Do you give thanks for your food at the table? I believe God, supernaturally, adds a blessing of health to those who give thanks for their food. I was saying this to a friend of mine in a restaurant. And we were young, and he wasn't afraid. So he got up. He said, you're right. We didn't pray. He got up, got on his knees. And I'm thinking, well, you don't have to, in a restaurant, get down on your knees and start praying. But he did. Now, the guy that was saying, we need to give thanks, now I'm blushing, because he's made a big scene out of it. The truth is, you don't have to make a big scene. If you read in the Old Testament, Hannah prayed to herself. Her lips were moving, but nothing was coming out. We call that silent prayer. Your lips don't even have to move. You can pray in your thoughts. God will hear it. Even in a restaurant, you can stop, you can pause, you can bow your head, and you can say, thank you, Lord, for the food that you have so bountifully provided. Whatever you say. And he will hear you. You just think it in your thoughts. You give thanks unto the Lord because he will consecrate it. Let me sum this up. We need godly leaders because of who we are. We are God's church. We are God's people. Because of what Jesus did, he actually appeared in the flesh and all those things that were listed there. Because what we oppose all hypocrisy. We are to be the standard of righteousness. And because of what we know the truth. We know the truth. And so we should live it. You see, godly leaders will guide us so that we will get the most out of church. Of course, we must follow their lead in order to get the most out of church. And that's what he's telling Timothy. Timothy, you be the example so that the others can follow, so that they'll all get the most out of church. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we pray. As we've looked into your word today and it's spoken to our hearts, And perhaps there's some part of this that has just touched my own life and saying, you know, I'm going to go from this place, clinging on to that through the week. Bless me, O Lord. So that as an individual, when I gather together collectively with the people of God who are the church, I get the most out of church. So work in my life, in the area that you've impressed upon me, O Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.